Last time we covered the primary stats, but today we're going to be covering physical combat, hit caps, crit caps, and glancing blows and crushing blows. We'll also talk about what the attack table is and how to manipulate it, and this will make a lot more sense in context. But when I say caps, I mean things that you do not want to exceed. A lot of the time, it will be very good to reach or get really close to them, but the significance of these numbers is that you should under no circumstances strive to exceed them. When we talk about damage mitigation, things like armor and block, we also talk about things like damage avoidance. If we want to accurately explain how avoidance works, we need to understand how combat works, and in order to understand how combat works, we need to first understand weapon skill and defense skill. So opening your skill panel, you'll see your skills, not to be confused with spells and abilities. In vanilla, your skills have a maximum level, which will be your level times 5, not including added skill points you get from either gear or racial passives. For example, at level 60, your maximum skill in anything will be 300. When you attack, your weapon skill will be compared to your opponent's defense skill. For every 1 point of your weapon skill that exceeds your opponent's defense, you essentially increase your chance of landing the attack by 0.2%. Specifically, that 0.2% chance is broken down into the following. Your crit chance, increase of 0.04%. Your miss chance, decrease of 0.04%. Opponent's block, parry, and dodge chance, all decrease of 0.04%. This can be the inverse as well. For every 1 point your opponent's defense skill exceeds your own weapon skill, then your crit chance decreases by 0.04%, your miss chance increases by 0.04%, and so on and so forth. Now before moving forward, let's talk about what these actually are. These are called attack results, and all of the possible attack results are as follows. Hit, critical hit, miss, block, parry, dodge, glancing blow, and crushing blow. Let's ignore those last two just for now. I said before, critical hits are hits that deal double damage. A miss is an attack that does not hit at all. When wearing a shield, a block has a chance to recur and reduces the physical damage taken by the character's block value. Small side note, blocking is not really considered avoidance, but rather mitigation. However, it is important in this section. A parry has a chance to occur for warriors, hunters, rogues, and paladins, and shamans if they take a talent. When you parry an attack, you completely mitigate all the damage you would take, and you also gain 40% attack speed for your next auto attack. This is incredibly useful for characters who use big, slow, two-handed weapons. And finally, a dodge has a chance to occur for all classes, completely mitigating a physical attack. Unlike parry, when you dodge, you don't get any added effects, but also unlike parry, your dodge chance can be increased through your agility stat. So I said that the chance of these attack results can increase or decrease based on the difference between the attacker's weapon skill and the opponent's defense skill. Miss, block, parry, and dodge each have their own base chance of 5%, meaning in perfectly equal combat, where the player has maximized his weapon skill for his level and the NPC is the same level as the player, the player's attack has a 5% chance to miss, a 5% chance to be blocked, a 5% chance to be dodged, and a 5% chance to be parried. Glancing blow in this case is 10%. The crit chance you have is based on the player's talent, gear, stats, etc. And for the sake of the example, I'm just going to say that we have 10% chance to crit. And then when you add all these up and subtract it from 100%, you get your actual hit chance, in this case 60%. Now this is a simplified explanation of what we call the attack table. Where it gets more complicated and where we actually start min-maxing is when we talk about the priority of these attack results. The priority changes a bit depending on who is attacking whom, but for now let's focus on a player attacking an NPC as we can see here. So I said this leaves me with a 60% chance to hit. Now if I equip an item here that gives me an added 1% crit, 1% of something else has to be taken away in order for us to maintain this perfect 100%. I don't get to take that away from something like block or glancing blow, it gets taken away from my hit, because my crit has more priority than my hit, which has the least priority. So, I still have the exact same chance to lose or waste my attack on one of those worst attack results, but I do technically have a higher chance of critting. In this instance, with this 1% hit that we lost, we call that pushing it off the attack table. Now let's talk about the glancing blows. A glancing blow is a type of hit that only has a chance to occur when a player auto-attacks an NPC of equal or greater level. Glancing blows do not happen to spells or abilities. A glancing blow counts as a hit, but the player will only do 70% of normal damage. There are two theories as to what generates the chance of a glancing blow. Theory 1 says whenever you fight an NPC of equal or greater level, your glancing blow chance is 10% plus 2% for every 1 point your opponent's defense exceeds your own weapon skill. Theory 2 is a lot simpler. It says that glancing blow chance starts at 10% when the mob is at your level and increases by 10% for every level the mob exceeds the player's. Either way, the result is the same. This means 40% for raid bosses. So, can we get rid of glancing blows? Well, no, but actually, yes. Both theories say that your weapon skill cannot change your chance to glancing blow, but that contradicts Theory 1, initially at least. Theory 1 specifies that any weapon skill past your normal maximum will not decrease your chance to glancing blow. However, both theories agree that for every point in your weapon skill you have that is above 300, in this case for a level 60, you'll gain 3% damage to your glancing blows. Meaning, if you have a weapon skill of 310, at level 60, then your glancing blows now deal 100%, essentially making them normal hits. We would call this effectively pushing glancing blows off the table. So to illustrate how the priorities of the attack table work in a setting that's actually applicable and useful, let's imagine a scenario in which a level 60 melee character who is not dual wielding is attacking a raid boss. The not dual wielding part I'll address in a moment. I picked this specifically because this is the scenario that melee characters in raiding base their character builds and gear lists off of. You'll see just why in a second. Here is a written explanation for these numbers that you're about to see. Pause the video to read it. The superscript numbers in the following slide correspond to the reasonings. So, our goal is to figure out how to maximize our ability to land attacks on the target, effectively increasing our damage output. Our attack table is 8% miss, 6.5% dodge, 14% parry, 40% glancing blow, and 5% block. So, how do we mitigate this hit loss? Well, first off, we can't do anything about the 6.5% dodge. However, so long as we're not main tanking this boss, we can completely remove the parry and block from the equation simply by standing behind the boss. If we attack an NPC or another player from behind, they cannot parry or block, so this gives us 19% more hit chance. What about miss chance? Well, if you see a piece of gear that says improves your chance to hit by 1%, that doesn't give you 1% hit chance, that removes 1% miss chance. So if we get 8% of that, we'll knock out miss chance, and now all we have to worry about is glancing blows. Well, we already explained that we can't change the chance of glancing blows, but we can negate all the damage by gaining 10 weapon skill. In doing all of this, we've effectively increased our chance to hit by 27%, and 19% of that came from positioning alone. If we're ranged physical DPS, meaning a hunter, there are a couple things we can change. Ranged attacks cannot be dodged or parried at all, and they don't have glancing blows. All the other rates remain the same. So what about dual wielders? Well, normally the base chance to miss is 5%, but for dual wielders, the base chance to miss is 24%, and since we're fighting a raid boss, we add 3% miss chance to that, and now we have a 27% miss chance. If we're dual wielding, we're a DPS player. As we said before, DPS players will be standing behind the boss with the boss facing away from us. If our target is facing away from us, then our target cannot parry or block, so we can drop parry and block chance from the attack table immediately. Now we have 73.5% to not hit normally, leaving 26.5% shared by hit and crit. Rogues and Fury Warriors are the prime suspects for dual-wielding melee DPS, and guess what? They love crit. Here we run into the problem of what is called the crit cap. Rogues and Fury Warriors can easily exceed 30% crit chance from gear and talents, and they won't be able to use that crit chance because of this priority system. The extra crit they have is going to get pushed off the table, so how do we fix this? By getting talents or gear that says improves your chance to hit, because remember, that removes miss chance, freeing up space for lower priority attack results, in this case crit chance. And since we just talked about crit cap, let's talk about hit cap. In the first example, we reached our hit cap, and we wouldn't want more than 8% of added hit chance because it would just be wasted, because we only have an 8% chance to miss. In this example, however, we see that we can get rid of 27% miss chance, so our hit cap would be 27%. But that's borderline impossible and definitely impractical. So when it comes to dual-wielding DPS, we strive for what is called the yellow hit cap. This is the hit cap concerning your abilities instead of your auto attacks. It's called the yellow hit cap because when you use your damaging abilities, the damage numbers that pop up are in yellow instead of white, which denote auto attacks. Your abilities still only have an 8% chance to miss, so you'll want to get at least 8% plus hit. But like I said before about crit cap, you also want to make sure that you have enough plus hit gear taking away your chance to miss to clear up room for any added crit chance that you've accrued through talents or gear. So this covers attack tables from players to NPCs. If we're attacking another player in PvP, thankfully the hit tables don't change too much. If anything, they just get a little bit simpler. We treat the hit table as if we're attacking a character of equal levels, and we also remove glancing blows. If the player doesn't have a shield, we also remove blocking. That's it. You're done. So, what this means is, your chance to miss as a non-dual wielder is 5%, and 24% as a dual wielder. What we haven't talked about, however, is the attack table for an NPC hitting a player, which is extremely important for tanks. Like the previous examples, the NPC will focus on as a raid boss. If we're just factoring in our base defense skill without any talents or gear, we get a minus 0.6% to all things that the defense skill and the weapon skill comparison factors in. A raid boss's attack table will baseline look like this. The chance for an attack to miss you is 4.4%. The chance for you to dodge, parry, or block an attack is 4.4% as well. The chance for you to receive a crushing blow is 15%. The chance for you to be crit at baseline is 5.6%. With all that in mind, our chance to be hit is 82.4%. Since we know how most of everything works here already, I want to focus on crushing blows and how to manipulate this hit table as a tank. Mobs can score crushing blows if they are 3 or more levels above the victim, or when their weapon skill is 15 or more above the defender's defense skill. The minimum chance to crushing blow is 15% and cannot be reduced regardless of the defense skill. However, the NPC will gain 2% chance to crushing blow for every point of defense the tank is missing past 15 points. Meaning that since the NPC is treated as having 315 weapon skill, if the tank has 299 defense skill, the NPC now has 17% chance to crushing blow. If the tank has a 298 defense skill, the NPC has a 19% chance to crushing blow, and so on. Increasing our defense skill does, however, increase the opponent's chance to miss, and increases our chance to dodge, parry, and block. Most importantly, it decreases the boss's chance to crit. In fact, we can entirely push it off the table, and here's how. We're at 300 base defense, the boss is at 315 weapon skill, resulting in 5.6% chance to crit for the boss. Now we need to know how many skill points in defense it takes to fully remove 5.6%, so we divide by the value of one defense skill point, which is 0.04% as we said before. The result we get is 140, so we need 140 extra defense skill on top of our base 300, and our total defense cap is now 440. Now that we know our defense is 440, let's recalculate our other values. We now have a 10% chance to be missed and a 10% chance to dodge, parry, and block attacks. Crushing blow stays the same, but critical strike is now at 0%. The chance to be hit now is 45%. Now let's get back to crushing blows. Like I said before, you can't directly affect the chance of crushing blows occurring. Unlike glancing blows, we also can't negate the amount of damage we take. So how do we deal with crushing blows? Well, look at how the priority on the table has basically everything above crushing blows. We need to find a way to increase any combination of those four attack results by 60%. For warriors, this is incredibly easy. They just use the shield block ability, which increases their chance to block by 75%. Just remember though, once our block gets increased by 75%, that doesn't mean we now have 85% chance to block, we have a max of 70% chance to block, because we already used 30% of the attack table filled in the attack results above the block in priority. The last thing tanks have to worry about is resistance, and that's very situational, so we'll talk about that in the magic section. This concludes part 2. Check the description for links to the sources I cite in the video. I've also included a short discussion again as to how I use those sources and any skepticism I may have. Thank you for watching, and I hope this helped. Stay tuned for part 2, where we go over the spell hit system, resistances, and spell power coefficients.